This video is part of a series on how to install and use the HPE 3-part Docker volume plugin within a Red Hat OpenShift environment. In this demo, we will be using a 3-node OpenShift cluster with a single master and two worker nodes. They will be using iSCSI to connect to a 3-part 8440 array for volume provisioning. The first step is to clone the 3-part Docker volume plugin repo from GitHub in order to get access to the installer. Once we have it downloaded, we can navigate to the installer folder. Within the installer folder, there are some important files to note. First is a host file, which Ansible will use to deploy various components of the 3-part Docker volume plugin on the OpenShift master and worker nodes. The properties folder contains the configuration file for your 3-part, and I will show you how that's done shortly. Once those two files are configured, we can run the installation playbook that will deploy the plugin into your OpenShift cluster. Let's start by editing the host file. Ansible uses the host file to describe your environment using labels, and with this information will deploy specific components for the 3-part Docker volume plugin on the master and worker nodes. The all label contains the host names or IPs for all of the OpenShift nodes in your cluster. If you use a proxy in your company, you can configure it here. Next, add the host names or IPs of the OpenShift master and worker nodes. The last section is used to define the hostnames or IPs that will be used to deploy the etcd cluster required for the 3-part Docker volume plugin to store volume and cluster metadata. Once this is done, go ahead and save and exit. Now let's take a look at the properties file in the properties folder. We'll make a quick backup of the sample file here. The properties file contains all of the details of the 3-part array or arrays that will be used for provisioning volumes within your OpenShift cluster. As you can see, there are multiple sections within the file, but don't be overwhelmed. I'll walk you through each section. Note the default and 3-part 1 labels in the file. These are used for each array that is configured for use by OpenShift. Only the array configured under the default label is required for the plugin to function properly. To start, if you're not going to need to configure OpenShift to use multiple 3-parts for volume provisioning, we can delete the 3-part 1 section. Under the mandatory parameter section, there are only a few changes that need to be made in order to configure the plugin. First, change the plugin driver to either Fibre Channel or iSCSI, depending upon your storage environment. Next, configure the hostname or IP address and username password for your 3-part array. One thing to note, the user will need edit rights on the array in order to add, delete, and modify volumes. Specify the CPG that will be used. Optionally, you can configure the snap CPG as well here. Additional settings are available, like encrypting the passwords or enabling 3-part replication within the plugin. These can be found within our documents on our GitHub page. Once this is all done, we can save and exit. We are now ready to install the plugin. We do this by running the Ansible-playbook command and specifying the host file we created earlier and the install HPE 3-part volume driver YAML file. Once Ansible finishes, you will have successfully installed the plugin. Now we will go through some basic usage to verify the 3-part Docker volume plugin installation and integrations within OpenShift using storage classes, persistent volume claims, and pods. Let's go ahead and download some pre-created examples from the 3-part examples repo. Navigate to the containers OpenShift samples folder. Within this folder, you will find working examples of a storage class, a persistent volume claim, and an Nginx pod. Let's go ahead and start with the storage class. The first steps of creating persistent volumes is to create a storage class, which acts like a storage profile that your users will consume when requesting storage for their applications. You can create multiple storage classes depending on your user needs, for example, a gold, silver, bronze type storage class. Within the storage class, we will specify a name, the provisioner 3-part driver will use, and then various parameters for each volume. You can refer to the documentation on our GitHub page for available options here. In this example, we'll be creating a simple storage class that will provision full volumes using the SSD R6 CPG. Now go ahead and save this file. We will now import the storage class into OpenShift with the OC create-f command. You can then verify that it was imported correctly by using the OC describe command, and you should see the parameters we set within the storage class. Now let's take a look at the sample persistent volume claim. The persistent volume claim, or PVC, contains several important parameters. First, it sets the access modes. Since we're using a 3PAR, which is a block device, we will be using the read-write-once setting. Next, specify the size and the storage class that will be used to provision the volume for your application. Once that's done, go ahead and save and exit. Now we will import the PVC into OpenShift using the same command as we did with the storage class. Again, we can inspect the PVC, at which point we will see the persistent volume has been created and bound, waiting for a pod to attach to. You can also inspect the persistent volume to get additional information or details on the volume. We'll be putting all of this together as we deploy an Nginx web server in a pod that will consume the volume we just created to store the website data. Let's take a look at the pod. Here we specify the container image that will be used and the mount location and PVC to be used for the persistent volume. The last section will expose the Nginx pod external to the cluster so we can see if everything is working as expected. Like before, we will import the pod specification into OpenShift and wait a few minutes as the pod is created. We can inspect the pod to see if it was created successfully. Now let's log into the pod to verify if everything is working correctly by writing some data to the new persistent volume. Once we've done that, we can get the IP of the pod and use curl to check the web server. If you see the output shown, you have successfully created a persistent volume using the HPE 3PAR Docker Volume plugin.